Hi there, I'm Drizzle. If this is your first time seeing our content, please like, comment, and subscribe if you wanna. I don't know, calls to action are weird. We have a Patreon and a Ko-fi and merch if you want it. Anyway, trigger warnings for this video are racial injustice, colonialism, racism, and capitalistic exploitation. Happy Black History Month. Take care of yourselves. And enjoy the rest of the video.
There's this thing that black folks often say about Black History Month: that we're black every month of the year. Sometimes that's to invoke the idea that black history and black lives matter every month of the year. Other times, it's to invoke the idea that Black History Month is a token gesture at best. After all, not the world nor America really operates any differently this month. It's business as usual. It's really the same as Pride Month, a time that's often co-opted for optics by companies and folks who want to seem inclusive or accepting, but really just want head pats and to make money. That's not to say that cultural wellsprings aren't gushing, though. There are black art initiatives and charities and celebrations, even in the heart of the pandemic, where many folks are just trying to get through the day emotionally as much as financially, not trying to pay so much attention to news that they can't function. There are always plenty of train wrecks to see, after all, and a lot of powerlessness to go with them. Sometimes, even when we avert our eyes. As a person of color, there are plenty of painful things to see and experience. The killing of Amir Locke reminded us the idea of diversity celebrations being chiefly ornamental makes sense. Not to say the cops who busted into the apartment that he was in were suddenly gonna go, "Oh, he's black, it's Black History Month, we shouldn't kill him yet." But in current year 2022, after Black Lives Matter protests that seemingly rocked the world at the start of the pandemic, and hearkening on leaders to dismantle militarized police departments and focus on public welfare and mental health, still highly preventable police violence is still a problem. But you probably clicked on this video because of VTubers. Hold on.
Oh my God! Oh my God!
Iron Mouse is currently one of Twitch's top broadcasters, with over 1 million followers and 100,000 subscriptions. She surpassed even Pokimane. Wild. This is something a lot of gaming news outlets care about right now, especially since she's reached those numbers while in the middle of a subathon that is 23 days and counting. Ironically, she's been streaming almost the entire month. If you don't know what a subathon is, it's a marathon for subs. Usually it involves a streamer doing something for every sub or set number of subs that they receive. Like, for every 5 subs, chat gets to choose my game. A common sub reward would be to lengthen the stream, which is what Iron Mouse has done. 15 seconds per sub. If she went for a day straight before any subs, that would be 285,120 subs alone, or the bit cheering equivalent, as she's accepting those too. I don't want to do the math on how much money that is from my modest estimate, but let's just say it's a lot. And if you're so curious about the amount of money that Iron Mouse makes, need I remind you that there was a leak, so you can see what any VTuber who was operating last year was making, including us. As I'm writing this, over 12,000 people have her stream up. Shit, even me. If you're unfamiliar with Iron Mouse, you may be confused how this has anything to do with Black History Month, or diversity in general. Other than maybe the fact that she's Twitch's top female broadcaster right now, and that's a big enough deal by itself. However, despite how her model looks, Iron Mouse is a person of color, and disabled to boot. Hell, Pokimane is also a person of color. Twitch's top broadcasters may slide overwhelmingly cis, but there are a number of black and brown faces among them. Iron Mouse is Puerto Rican. This isn't even deep lore.
Oh my god, me voy la cabecita. Ay, Dios mío, me voy la cabeza.
She speaks Spanish on stream sometimes, even teaching chat a few words in Spanish on occasion. She's very proud of her heritage and does not hide it. I don't think that part can be contested. It pisses me off that new outlets such as Kotaku rave over her success as a femme streamer without even the slightest mention of her heritage. So we made this. I know there might be a compulsion, especially in VTuber fandom, to want to be colorblind, especially since Iron Mouse hasn't done her face reveal, and it's much easier to think of her as her model and her model only. Funny, since this year Twitter has seen a slew of VTubers doing face reveals and captioning them with the words to the effect of immersion broken. In an attempt to fight back against the prevailing notion that VTubers should stay in character, and that not doing so is like a video game having glitches just when you hit flow state. Such a drag. It's really an extension of the ownership the worst of the VTube viewing community has over VTubers themselves. It's been a thing for a long time. Long enough that Drizzle's VTube essay is still hella relevant. Because of the way the parasocial view can distort a sense of authenticity, and because of the shitty way anime fandom can enforce toxic beauty and personality standards, there are those who, despite being VTuber fans, desperately want for those behind the avatar to essentially be how they see the characters, as waifu. In that essay, she even talked about Iron Mouse and how she's an example of what VTubing can do for a person. For self-actualization, for having a job even when you're disabled, and for being the representation that so many in entertainment regularly deny folks the opportunity to see. Be the representation you want to see in the world. For folks that don't know much about Puerto Ricans, I read a Wikipedia article, and you can too, but I skimmed it just to be sure I wasn't talking out of my ass on this. And hell did I find out a lot. However, we do have some experience with this topic. Growing up, one of my system's best friends was Puerto Rican, and very black. He used to argue to us that Puerto Ricans at large could use the N-word, not just ones that are, black passing. This is something that comes up from time to time, especially when talking about mixed-race black people, both those who do and don't pass as white. Hell, we've even heard light-skinned black folks being interrogated about what they can do and say. And we may have experienced some of that ourselves as well. There is a lot of nuance to be had, but black culture and Puerto Rican culture aren't strangers. The colonization of Puerto Rico, which still occurs to this very day, is a reflection of not just the subjugation and abuse of indigenous people, but of people of color at large. Puerto Rico started as a Spanish colony, eventually had its enslaved indigenous population emancipated conveniently after their population diminished enough that the colonists needed to start importing African slaves to keep up with labor shortages. It hurt me greatly to type the word importing, but black people weren't considered people. There was a number of slave rebellions, one leader of which, Marcos Zalio, which I may be pronouncing wrong, became a Puerto Rican folk hero. Later, and I'm skipping a bunch of history here, the Spanish-American War happened, and America won Puerto Rico as a prize. And it wasn't until 2009 that the US put in considerable effort towards allowing Puerto Rico self-determination, which Puerto Ricans at large were in favor of, obviously. But even within the Obama administration, the US was still pulling rank in governing Puerto Rico as a colony. Sorry, territory. In 2020, a referendum determined that 52% of Puerto Rican voters still desired statehood, which is 3 years after Hurricane Maria devastated the place and was denied adequate aid by the then President Trump. And for the record, the other 48 weren't necessarily in favor of staying things the way they were. To this day, many have failed to recover from the devastation of the hurricane. Many were forced to migrate, and many have died unnecessarily. Shit. They were at large without power for a year. The lack of resources given to respond to tragedy grimly reflects other marginalized communities left belly up in the wake of climate disasters, like those devastated by Hurricane Katrina. We're also still suffering to this day. Economic disparity is still the reality there. And it's easy living on the internet to forget that. These facts aren't something you'll hear much about on Iron Mouse's streams, of course. She's not a political streamer. But the economic uncertainty that many Puerto Ricans experience as a consequence of their tumultuous history and current systemic oppression isn't something lost on her. This past Christmas, she paid off her parents' house, and her mom was flabbergasted.
Of course she deserves it. And now she never has to worry ever again. No more worry. I actually paid off my mom's house for Christmas.
When she first started making a large income from streaming, her mom was scared Iron Mouse had acquired the funds illegally. Prosperity and security was something that streaming provided her and her family, and it's amazing and inspiring. And it's not just inspiring to me, as someone of color, but also as someone with a disability, or rather, many. Iron Mouse has CIVD, common variable immunodeficiency, which makes her particularly susceptible to infections, as those with it have a very weak immune system. She has to be on oxygen 24/7 and doesn't leave the house. Under capitalism, she would be seen as a burden, doubly so for being in a family of color, where it's very normal for someone to get a job to help out their family, even as children or teenagers. It's just what you have to do.
I feel like my whole life, like, we were always like, that was always like a danger. It was like a threat looming over our head. I remember so many years of my life, my mom, like, awake at like 4 a.m. like, worrying. And at the time, like, she didn't know what was happening to me. And slowly things started changing for me. And things started changing and she didn't really know. And she didn't understand. And I remember when I got partnered and everything just started snowballing out of control. And I approached my parents and I told them, no more crying. I got you. And when I told my parents, my mom was scared for like a month. She was like, is this legal?
But streaming has allowed her agency over her own life and the ability to take care of her family that would be very impossible otherwise, especially to this degree. Something that many marginalized entertainers want desperately, and something that many see as a possibility because of the popularity of streamers such as Iron Mouse or Pokimane. Iron Mouse is Puerto Rican and Hispanic, so I'd assume that she doesn't see herself as Black, since I can't find any record of her ever saying or talking about it, which is why I've done my best not to say that. Though, many Puerto Ricans have at least partial roots in Africa. Their cultural identity is a lot more nuanced than, say, that of the average Black American. Black, non-Puerto Rican American. There's even a large amount of Puerto Ricans who self-determine as white, at least according to the census. The white part is influenced by the Spanish roots in many of Puerto Ricans' heritage. However, the category of white, I suspect, isn't a reflection of many Puerto Ricans' lived experience, because culturally white, in the framing of a lack of ethnic identity and heritage, doesn't seem reflective of the Puerto Rican lived experience. Hispanic counts as white depending on who you're talking to, and filling out background boxes for the government could never fully express what a person's lived experience as their race really is. However, I think it speaks volumes that some Puerto Ricans have rethought the answer to those consensus questions in the face of the overwhelming racism that blocked much of their aid after the hurricane in 2017. Not to mention the push of some Puerto Ricans to educate their fellow citizens about the influence of Afro-Puerto Rican contributions to their culture in hopes many more people will start to identify as Black. It's not a matter of Black roots not being there, but of the implication that being Black presents. In the New York Times article I'm reading from while I'm writing this, many Puerto Ricans say that they also feel that choosing Black erases their unique cultural identity, including language, food, and customs, and aligns their experience too closely with that of African Americans on the mainland. And in that context, it makes a lot of sense that many would not self-determine as Black, especially given that being Black is for many synonymous with Black American culture and life. The shared identity of Black, and not necessarily African-American Black, is rooted in the near universal struggle under systemic racism and oppression, and the fight for liberation. Many folks, Black and otherwise, see being Black through the lens of the American struggle, romanticized through the civil rights movement. We've even seen people try to gatekeep Black identity from people depending on what they think racial injustice was or is like in the part of the world the person they're gatekeeping comes from. Like saying you can't celebrate Black History Month if you're not an American Black person, which is misguided at best. Black History Month has been rough this year. As a VTuber, it's been filled with happiness, but a lot more sadness. There was discourse about white VTubers with Black models, specifically those that let people assume or outright say that they are Black, until it comes out that they're lying. Something similar happened with makeup content creators on sites like Instagram, even years before now, where some use their skills to do the most elaborate blackface ever, garnering a lot of success and visibility, at least before they were revealed to not be Black at all. It's indicative of the same thing that the Fortnite Black Dance lawsuit and controversy reveals, that Black people, our culture, and our art are very profitable for folks who aren't us, that our lives are only as important as what we can do or be exploited for. And that also counts for any person of color, as our culture and our identity is served as nice and meaty content for white America. If you got this far in the video, I'm under the assumption that you do believe Black Lives Matter. Well, there's that at least. We have, as far as we can tell, a very majorly white audience, and sometimes that's kind of stressful. We hold ourselves far too accountable for what our fan base does or thinks, and we even purposely don't use the N-word in content because even if folks are at the end of the day responsible for their own actions, people do pick up things from their favorite creators. When you spend time around someone or consuming their content, like 12-hour streams and marathoning all of someone's YouTube videos, their words can become a part of you. Shout out to everyone who says horror adorable in their everyday life now. When you look at folks like FD Signifier and Verdius Joe with admiration and respect, and think very often on where we fall relative between them, or outside that spectrum entirely. We're a role model whether we like it or not now. Something that content creators at large, but also marginalized ones, are typically burdened with. Although seeing a boom in visibility regarding Black and brown VTubing talent does put a smile on my face, as well as the amount of folks willing to engage in topics like the ones in this video. Iron Mouse's success makes us very happy, and we've even taken cues from her with our own content when we first started. But we'd also like to see a majorly successful VTuber with a Black model find just as much visibility. Maybe now that a Black VTuber production company exists and is trying to make waves, maybe that's a possibility. But above all, we'd love for the entertainment industry not to be the last resort for so many folks trying to survive, self-included. Happy Black History Month. Hi there, you've made it to the end of the video. Really appreciate you for that. I feel horribly stiff and amazingly inorganic, but I'm going to try to do calls to action and stuff anyway. First off, thanks for watching so much. YouTube Analytics tells us that a lot of people don't make it to the end of videos. Up until a point, we thought it was just us, but hearing other creators talk about it sounds like YouTube just really wants to give you a complex about how many people watch your videos and how many people get bored of them and turn them off. And given that you've made it this far in the video, that you get to hear me even talk like this, I can't help but feel a duty to do my best. If you want to support us, there's a lot of ways to do it. We have a Ko-fi if you want to just help out one time. We have a Patreon if you want to, or Patreon if you want to support us on a regular basis. You'll get your name at the end of videos, and you'll also sometimes get updates on what we're doing. We try to make a content related update at least once a week, something like that. We also have merch somehow. It's on Redbubble. A couple of t-shirts. It's kind of cool. But there are people who already support us, and we'd like to give a warm thanks to those people right now. Thank you, Knots Vulps, R2 Walker, Tin Lufu, Value Customer, Nova System, and Corin System. And a double thanks to Tin Lufu, considering we missed your name last time. Really appreciate you staying, despite that. And before I close out, I also want to do a little eyeball zoning, I guess, and platform another creator. Evan, who is a VTuber and animator, is trying to get a project off the ground. It's called Lumi and the Great Big Galaxy. Right now it has 9 days left on Kickstarter, and it's very, very close to its goal. It's a cumulative project, considering there's a webtoon for it that has been made for over the last 3 years. It's already had a lot of voice talent attached to it, and I believe that there is a pilot that has been produced, even if it hasn't been released yet.
You're telling me this entire planet is underwater? Devin!
I don't know about this, Siona. What? Only the greatest part of our history?
Hey! I said stop it!
Careful not to shine too bright, little star. For I might see you.
Considering Evan is a small content creator like us, who's of color and queer, and a colleague of ours, we wanted to do something special, and we wanted to start doing this regularly, where we platform other creators, kind of like what ThoughtSlime does at the end of their videos. Gosh, this is kind of awkward, especially since it's been so long since we did one of these end of video things, and after the hiatus and stuff, everything feels weird and new and awkward. Apologies for that, and thanks for watching. Take care of yourselves.